Obtaining a quality education is incredibly valuable. Not only does education equip us with knowledge, it equips us with friendships, opportunities to develop leadership qualities, ways to contribute, and most importantly, the ability to learn. But how much of a financial impact does providing a quality education have? This was the purpose of some research that we have conducted recently on behalf of Futurity Investment Group. So joining me today to discuss some of the insights that we garnered from this research is McCrindle's research strategist, Jason Authers. Jace, welcome to the podcast.
Thanks, Ash. It's great to be here.
It's really exciting. You're coming to us from our Sydney hub, even though you are based over in the West in our Perth hub. But I thought because it's your debut on the podcast, it'd be great for our audience to get to know you a little bit. So, Jace, I'd be keen for you to share with our audience how you describe what your role is at McCrindle.
Great. It's definitely one of those questions that you get asked when you go to parties or barbecues. You're meeting people for the first time, so they ask, what do you do? And I think at McCrindle, we love to answer that question, even though it's a complicated question at times. But essentially, I help design research solutions for our clients and our accounts, really with the focus of building client partnerships. And we're really passionate about the relationships that we can develop at McCrindle across so many different sectors. And so helping pioneer and set up our account management strategy and working on research projects, delivering those research projects, so whatever the output may be. And I've been really privileged to work alongside some amazing clients in my role here at McCrindle.
Yeah, you are a very valuable member of our team, and it's always a hard question for family and friends, especially like to answer, you know, like what is like my, for my mom and my husband, you know, like what does Ashley do for work? Like, oh yeah, she works in research, you know, let's move on. So no, it's a really, really exciting place to work and always learning new things. And like you said, I think the variety of clients we get to work with is such a privilege. And especially, I think, particularly within the education sector, we love this sector. We do a lot of work with this sector and for this sector, which is what we're talking about today. So, Jace, I'd love for you to share as well with our audience a little around, I guess, any reflections you have on how important your education has been to you and where you've ended up, you know, even here at McCrindle.
I love this question, Ash, and you're right in saying we're huge fans of the education sector, and we work with so many education-based clients, whether it's a client like Futurity or schools themselves or education thought leaders and peak bodies. And so throughout my time here at McCrindle, I've been exposed to so many aspects and facets of education that I've been really privileged to be a part of. But education has been such an integral part of my journey. I grew up in Zimbabwe and moved to Australia in 2004 with my family. And in fact, education opportunities and having access to a better education was one of the key reasons we actually moved from Zimbabwe through to Australia. And school for me when we first moved was this really important part of my life. It was an opportunity for me to become assimilated and connect with my life in Australia. It was an opportunity for me to discover who I was in this new context that I found myself in. And so I'm so grateful for that opportunity. It's been a place for me to develop my skills, obviously, for to become educated. But fast forward to my later years in school, there were several teachers and, in fact, even the principal of the school that I was part of were really intentional investing in me and helped develop, I guess, foundational aspects of my life, whether that's identity or the way I saw my skills and the way that I looked at life, perspectives. And so I'm deeply grateful to the educators that I've had across my time. And in fact, there was one teacher I had in year 12 that really encouraged me and inspired me to go on and study teaching for a time. I didn't end up finishing that degree, but it was definitely something that had a lasting impact in my life.
Yeah, that's amazing. I mean, we're going to talk about today some pretty, I don't know if confronting is too much of a negative word, but some really sobering, also a bit of a negative word, but some intense stats around the cost of education for families to send their children to different kind of sectors of schools. And I'm the same as you, though. I, you know, even before we delve into this topic, it feels like you and I are both people who have benefited from some really quality education from some teachers who showed real interest in us. Mm. I attribute a lot of my current, success, and I said in inverted commas because it's such a vague word, but like for where I am today and what I love doing and the passion for my job and role and family, you know, from a lot of the people that invested in me through my high school particularly. And for me, even for my family, it was a bit of a stretch to send myself and my sibling to this particular school economically. And I'm just so grateful that they did, because I feel like it changed the trajectory of my life. So really excited to talk about this topic today. We've garnered some really fascinating insights about education. So you, as the lead on this project, Jace, have got some key insights to share about this. So be keen to start with, I guess, the purpose behind, you know, this research and even the methodology to get our audience in the vibe of, I guess, what we conducted and why we conducted it.
Yeah, that's so right, Ash. And what I love, and I'm deeply inspired by the work that Futurity is doing. And their vision is that everyone has access to education and lifelong learning opportunities needed to fulfill their aspirations. And, being able to come alongside clients that have these very purposeful visions and sense of mission, it so aligns with the work that we do here at McCrindle, that is to empower human flourishing. And as you said, education is such an integral part of empowering the next generation to go on to fulfill the lives of meaning and purpose that they want to aspire to. And so being able to provide this research and this thought leadership that informs people about the true cost of education is such an important aspect. And so that is, I guess, the essence or the aim around this research, so that people across Australia, education leaders, parents are informed of what's involved in the financial cost of education. And more importantly, I'd say, understanding the impact that may have on families as they aspire to provide quality education for their children. And so Futurity wants to come alongside them and support them in that. So to do that, we conducted a national survey of over 1,500 parents across all the different states and territories in Australia, the different school sectors, different school stages, depending on the age of their children. And then we boosted that with an additional 770 responses to have really robust data so that we could segment across state, across school sector, across school stage as well, so that we could have those robust insights in those different contexts.
Yeah, fantastic. It's really great to, as you said, align with organizations who've got that alignment of values and priorities. And yeah, Futurity are doing amazing work here. And real thought leaders in this space to be able to conduct this research in a really robust way, as you mentioned there with the methodology. So Jace, how important do people see education being in Australia? What did the research tell us about how people in Australia value education?
The research affirms wholeheartedly that Australian parents really believe education is important for their children to thrive in life. And I think it's almost a given. I think almost everyone would understand and recognize that Australians have access to great education and that parents recognize that it's such a key part in setting children up for life. But I was really surprised to see how many parents are committed to contributing to their child's lifelong education aspirations. In fact, one in two parents believe it is their role to financially contribute to their child's lifelong education. A third believe it's their role to contribute through primary, secondary, and tertiary education. And only 14% believe it's their role to only contribute up until the end of secondary education. And so I think what I took away from that was parents are taking very seriously their responsibility to, one, obviously lead their children through their formative years, but also to put their money where their mouth is, so to speak, and actually back their education into the rest of their life, not even up until the end of tertiary education.
Yeah, it's amazing. And again, I feel like I see these stats and I think about my own journey, as I alluded to earlier, just even around for my family and my parents, the school that they chose to send my brother and I to did require a fair bit of sacrifice in terms of, like, mainly I think for us, as we reflect on it, like, you know, in hindsight, it was the idea that we didn't go on as many overseas trips, like if any actually, while we were at school, because the cost of sending us to that school was quite high. And so, yeah, there's responsibility, there's sacrifice, which we're going to talk about even just around the cost. So it's a significant undertaking for parents, this responsibility. Did the research tell us anything about how parents are preparing for this particularly financial responsibility around sending their children to what they believe to be, you know, a quality school or to obtain a quality education?
I mean, the stat that I alluded to just before was 86% of parents believe education is extremely or very important to thriving in life, but only half have been extremely or very intentional in preparing for the cost of education. And so it's interesting to see that parents, yes, they recognize the value of it, but not all parents have prepared equally or in equal measure for the costs involved. And I think recognizing that is such a key to education organizations and thought leaders to help inform, like this research is trying to do, help inform parents about this cost. And I think, you know, it's in this context that it's important to know that only 37% of Australian parents describe their financial literacy as competent to advanced, whereas over 60% describe their financial literacy as basic to adequate. And I think the key insight that I drew out of that is, you know, parents having that financial literacy and that sense of intentionality around the cost of education is such an important aspect and really key to helping navigate that financial responsibility that they have.
Yeah, that's really interesting. The whole financial literacy kind of conversation, we've explored it in some other research even this year, I think for Insignia Financial, even around how equipped people feel with knowledge of how to be wise with their finances. And it's really interesting, I think, to see that, I wouldn't say maybe disconnect, but like the value and the majority of parents saying, yes, education is important. Yes, quality education is important. And I feel the responsibility for that. But then a heaps lesser proportion actually saying, well, I'm like taking active steps financially to prepare for that. And I feel like that's so common. I guess even with, like, we see it with other big financial commitments, like saving for a house or, you know, there's other things where people go, yeah, I want to obtain that goal. But if you ask me if I'm taking, you know, steps to actually put that in place, or if I'm maximizing my income, you know, to have that return on whatever the investment is, you know, it's financial literacy is just fascinating. And I can understand, I can empathize with those parents who are saying we value education, but we're not maybe taking, we're not feeling financially literate enough to actually be savvy. And it takes that probably long term. We're going to talk about the cost of education in just a sec, but like it's a big cost and probably what a lot of us underestimate. I feel like that was the conversation we were having even in the office when this research kind of came through. We were like, sorry, what? The cost of education is what now? Like those of us who haven't got kids yet or whatever, we're like, okay, better start planning now, you know? So, but I mean, let's talk about it. Let's talk about the cost of education. What did the research reveal? Take a deep breath about how much education, you know, can cost in Australia.
Totally. And I relate completely. I'm married, but don't yet have children. And as I was doing this research and uncovering the data, I was floored. I was really taken aback at the costs involved, even for government education, which obviously there's fees involved, but it's positioned as freely accessible. Even that is a pretty significant cost. And so definitely encourage people to go and look at the report. There's so much more data around the cost of education that we uncovered, whether it's ancillary costs or tuition fees broken down by states and the different sectors, so government, Catholic and independent, as well as the school stage. So primary and secondary obviously has different costs. So dive into that. But I wanted to just kind of share the high level cost of education across 13 years across the different sectors. So obviously having an insight and understanding, you know, the total cost across educating our children is key. So based on the figures in 2023, and then we extrapolate that across 13 years, applying inflation, et cetera, the cost for government education for 13 years would be an average of $84,554, which is, yeah, as I said, whilst positioned as freely accessible and obviously is the cheapest of the three, still has a really significant cost that I think parents aren't always immediately aware of. That cost also comes through on ancillary fees, whether that's school camps, uniforms, textbooks, resources, etc. And I know that different organizations as well as government bodies work hard to make education in the government sector really accessible to all different walks of life. Catholic school parents are paying on average $173,706 for 13 years of education. And then for independent schools, a whopping $288,000 over the 13 years of education. And so it's
that
definitely
is so much money.
It's an investment.
Yeah. Wow. And I guess like you said, like that's not a one-off payment or anything. That's over the course of that 13 years, you know, the entire time that they're in the school. But I mean, yeah, and I think what you said earlier, even just around government schools, which a lot of people think is the more affordable option, which that is true, it's definitely not cheap by any means or free by any means. Like you said, it's, you know, approaching that kind of $100,000 mark. You know, so yeah, that's really interesting. And yeah, we were talking about this even with some of my friends over the weekend who have kids, and we were talking about even like the average cost of raising a child over 18 years or something. And yeah, I mean, education, those ancillary costs, like you mentioned, really play into that, you know, figure. So I'd be keen to hear, Jace, did the research go into, I guess, the impact of this pretty significant cost on households and their finances?
Yeah, and I think I mentioned it just before, and this is what really excites me about this research, is understanding, yes, education is valued in Australia. Yes, education at the different sectors incurs a cost, but what is that cost and how is that coming to bear on families? And we know that education is just one aspect of the financial responsibilities that parents have. As you said, raising children has so many other expenses, whether that's their sports or their hobbies or medical expenses or food, you know, all of these things. And education fits within that. And so understanding how it's impacted, whether positively or negatively, or if parents are feeling in control, was a key part of this research. And just to speak to that real quickly, a third feel extremely or very overwhelmed about their financial situation. And only one in four feel in control of their finances. And so we position that just in a general kind of statement. But then digging into that a little bit further, four in five, so 82% of Australian parents, find paying for their child's education expenses has a negative impact on their finances, which I thought was a really staggering insight that yes, largely parents are feeling overwhelmed about their financial situation. And then within that, there is the sense of paying for the education that they want to provide for their children does incur some of these negative challenges. And what I particularly like about the large sample that we had as well, we're able to kind of break it down and segment the data. And parents with basic and adequate financial literacy, that piece that we were talking about just before, are nearly two times more likely to find education expenses having a significant or moderate negative impact on their household finances as compared to those with competent and advanced financial literacy. And so I think, again, that's really key, that building up the financial literacy of our Australian parents is such a key way to help prepare them and make the process of providing a quality education something attainable for our parents.
Yeah, absolutely. And I guess even this research is playing a part in that, hopefully, around just bringing awareness and data-led insight into even just, awareness of the cost of what education can look like and what to be prepared for and how early maybe we need to be preparing for it in light of what the costs actually are. I'd be keen as well, Jace, in light of this cost and the responsibility that we talked about that parents do feel around providing a quality education for their children, did the research reveal anything about whether parents believe that they're getting value for money when it comes to their child's education? Because I would imagine, some, and we talk about this actually in some of our advisory sessions with schools or even with the education sector, where when you're paying more money for a service, your expectation naturally kind of aligns with that and goes up. So those parents who are paying a lot of money on that upper end, hundreds of thousands of dollars for their child's schooling, their expectation is increased around what they expect they're getting from that kind of service, if we can talk about education in that way. So did the research reveal anything about, whether, Australian parents feel like it's good value for money with regards to, their kids' education?
Yeah, and this was really encouraging, seeing the insights here. So 85% Australian parents believe they are absolutely or somewhat getting value for money in the classroom and learning environments. And so we're seeing that while parents really they are not all preparing for the cost of education equally. They value education and they are seeing that actually come to fruition. I think that's a really encouraging insight and understanding that parents are buying in and leaning into the education experience. So much so that they're, we talked about it a little bit before, even yourself, you mentioned that your parents went without their sacrificed family holidays. And we asked a question to the parents that responded in the survey, what have they done to kind of meet the financial responsibility of providing the education? And we found that many parents have gone without buying things for themselves. They've sacrificed family holidays as well. They've struggled to pay bills. They've gone without buying things for their children. And some have even said that they've worked more hours than they've wanted to. And I think that just speaks to parents are willing to sacrifice because they see the value in the education that they're providing. And I think that's obviously, parents are so selfless and so generous in being able to leverage, I guess, their life so that they can set their children up for the future as well.
That's an amazingly high percentage. I think when you hear that 85% of Australian parents are absolutely or somewhat getting value for money in the classroom and learning environments, that's really encouraging. So pat on the back to anyone who's, working in the education sector, working some hard hours, as we learned from our, sector-wide study around the pressure that people in this profession have faced over the last few years and are facing, in light of the changes that the pandemic brought about and things like that. I know in this report, we also investigated parents and their current experience of their school or the school that their children are at. Did anything stand out to you particularly from this section of the research?
Yeah, again, this was really encouraging. And I think I love being able to tell these encouraging stories that, like you said, the education sector has gone through significant changes over the last couple of years. It's a difficult sector for many people, and there's pressures that are mounting with so many different variables coming to bear on the education sector. And so being able to encourage our education leaders and teachers with some of this data is really key for us. And so 2 in 3 parents are extremely or very satisfied with their child's school. And in fact, only 6% reported any level of dissatisfaction at all, which is staggering to see that, so many of our parents at varying levels, yes, but really are satisfied and leaning into the school that their children are going to and see immense benefit from that. I think there were a few challenges that were mentioned, but largely parents are satisfied with the school that their children are going to.
Yeah, absolutely. And I know even in this research, like you mentioned, some of those challenges, I think were around bullying, which is a major concern. And we found that in the research we were conducting around the Generation Alpha generation and the book that we did, just that it's kind of a lifelong, like it's always been that way. Parents of previous generations have always worried about bullying, and there's almost like this idea, and I think Mark's mentioned it before, that no school is perfect. And as much as we do and we should strive to make great, perfect schools, that's unrealistic maybe expectation. And there's great steps we can do to, you know, alleviate bullying and combat that.
Mm.
But, you know, you get that kind of issues in every school. And it's great to see even here that we talked about rising expectations of parents, maybe as a result of the rising costs, but the, I guess, interesting, I guess, narrative that sits alongside that is that parents are exhibiting and showing in this research a pretty high level of satisfaction, even though they've got high expectations. So again, like props to the people doing the great work in these sectors.
Yeah.
I'd be keen, Jace, to hear from you around, you know, in light of this research, what you feel or what you see the sentiment being among the parents that we've surveyed and explored and researched regarding the future of education, regarding where this is all kind of heading. Do you feel like there's a level of optimism, you know, in spite of these challenges? What's your feedback or ideas, I guess, on the sentiment of parents, particularly regarding, you know, where this is all heading?
Yeah, I think, I mean, this is obviously a question that really excites us here at McCrindle. We love looking toward the future and trying to understand the trends and data of today so that we can tell the story of the future and help inform people about what's taking place. And I was so encouraged to see the sense of commitment that parents exhibit and express towards their child's education, and that 3 in 4 parents are extremely or very excited about their children's education in the future. And just as many are actively involved in helping their children plan for their future education. And so I think, yeah, to speak into that a little bit further, they're not just excited about it in a sentimental, oh yeah, everyone's excited about the future, of course, education. But again, putting their money where their mouth is and actively involved in helping and guiding their children into their future education. And there was also a significant amount that have said that they are financially supporting their children's future education. And so definitely the sense is they're in it, they're excited, there's challenges, yes, but building on that deep level of satisfaction, that sense of value in the work that schools are doing, parents are committed as well to realizing the exciting future that lies before education.
Yeah, it's again, I feel like every time I speak to a school staff cohort at a professional development day or even friends, you know, who are teachers or working in the sector, and they exhibit a level of burnout, or it's always, oh yeah, the expectations on the sector and us is really high. I see part of this research as making a difference, even to encourage those working in the education sector to show this high level of satisfaction and value on the work that they're doing. That's really important. That's vocational. That's transforming lives of young people. So hopefully that's part of what the research is doing and making a difference. But how do you see it making a difference, Jace, with regards to, you know, the research that we've conducted in this really important area?
Yeah, and just before I speak into that, I wanted to also mention that teachers have this really pivotal role. Like we've both said, that, you know, some of our teachers and education leaders throughout our schooling help form us into the people that we are today. Parents are continuing to prioritize the development of human skills such as empathy, curiosity, and leadership as the most important skills to develop. And so teachers really have such an integral part alongside the parent to help form those key human skills that are setting up our children to, yes, be great workers and leaders in business and organizations, whatever it may be that they go on to do, but are equipped with the necessary human skills to actually outwork that. But answering your question and speaking into how this research may be making a difference, you know, part of what we love to do is ask the question, so what? So what about the data? So what? How is this going to make a difference in the real world? And, you know, I think specifically we've talked a lot about financial literacy being a key factor in parents realizing more positive outcomes and experiences for their children in education. And those with higher financial literacy are more intentional in preparing for that education expense. They experience less negative impacts in paying education fees and are more active in helping their children prepare for lifelong education. And so I think education organizations, schools, thought leadership-based organizations, peak bodies, etc., have an opportunity to help inform and educate parents as well on the cost of education. I think that is really key. The second thing that I just briefly wanted to highlight was while cost of education impacts a broad cross-section of society, it touches everyone's life. And I think it would be not correct of us to assume that it only impacts certain groups. However, there are certain groups within society that are facing significant challenges comparatively to others. And, you know, that could be single parents, regional households as well, came out through the data that they've experienced significant challenges, as well as lower income households. They all report feeling more overwhelmed by their financial situation. They all report experiencing more negative impacts associated with paying their education expenses. And they, on the most part, feel less equipped to support their children's lifelong education. And so I think whoever has the opportunity out there within the education sector to help bridge the gap with some of these groups and help these groups still provide the best education possible for their children to realize their aspirations in life, I think would be such a noble and purposeful opportunity for us to continue to leverage the great blessing that we have here in Australia and provide great education to children across the nation.
Yeah, it's such an important point. Like you mentioned, Jace, it's really encouraging research that we have conducted, and so many amazing statistics have come out of this that we've talked about and that you've shared so well today. But I think it's also important, as you said, really eloquently there, to remember that there are, like you said, groups in more difficult contexts, those single parent households, regional households, lower income households who, yeah, find it even harder, who have that desire, of course, I imagine, to send their child to a particular school or education, but that cost may be a prohibitor there, which we understand as well. I wanted to end just on a quick story, actually. I do a lot of presentations, as you know, Jace, with schools, and I, as I've mentioned throughout the podcast today, really attribute my career pathway where I am today to the high school that I went to. And again, like, obviously very exhibit a lot of gratitude to my parents for sending me there and sacrificing, you know, making sacrifices to send me there. But it was so many things about that school that I loved. And one of the teachers who really inspired me, actually, I was speaking at a school that her child goes to, and she wasn't able to attend it, but she sent me this email. This was only a couple of weeks ago, and she was like, "Oh, I see that you're speaking. Like, this is amazing. I don't know if you remember me." And I was like, "Of course I remember you. You were like so integral to my like love of English particularly and learning." And it was her passion more so than anything else that really, I guess, got me passionate about that subject, which kind of led me into the path I went down. So yeah, I think there's so many people I know in our team and around the world, around Australia, who are just, yeah, very thankful for those teachers who took an interest. And of course, we owe them gratitude, but we also, like we've talked about today, owe our families and our parents gratitude for making those sacrifices, you know, to send us to those schools. And we think of those especially who might not be able to feel like they can do that, and ways that we can, you know, support them through different ways is really important too. So really fascinating insights, Jace. Thank you so much for your time today. Thanks for conducting this great research. Thanks to Futurity as well for conducting this and for your time today.
Amazing. Thanks so much. Really appreciate the opportunity. And yeah, as we mentioned, we're hopeful that this research goes on to inspire meaningful contributions to the space. And so we're excited to see what comes from it.
Absolutely. And if you would like to stay up to date with our latest insight, including research projects and insights like we've done for Futurity, you can always subscribe to the podcast. You can follow us on social media, or you can head to McCrindle.com to stay up to date with what we've been up to. So as always, thank you again for listening. And just a note as well on actually this season of the podcast, this will be our final episode for a few weeks. We'll take a little bit of a break around, you know, school holidays and things like that. And we'll be back next season with some great new insights. So as always, thank you again for listening, for following us on the different platforms, and for your ratings. We really appreciate it. And goodbye for now.